there's something that I... It's almost like a bit of like wrestling trivia. So I think we're talking like 77 or around there. Bob Backlund's in Florida, and Vince McMahon Sr. has his eye on Bob to become the next WWF champion. Now, there are two rumours floating around, and I think in the book you sort of allude to them, or just say them outright, is that one, Vince McMahon Sr. and Eddie Graham had a $50 bet that Vince could get Bob over, and two, you, if Eddie had pushed hard, maybe, you could have been the person to be the WWF champion instead of Bob.
Well, here's the thing about that story. I mean, Kevin Sullivan talks about it quite a bit on podcasts because he was close in that time with Mike and Eddie. And, you know, he has a different slant. He was the one that brought up the $50 bet. But back then, when it was all happening, Bobby and I were actually partners here in Florida. And Bobby was, they were utilizing me to help develop Bobby because he had a little bit of a mechanical, unorthodox style to him. He was a great amateur and everything, but he was stiff. He wasn't loose, and he wasn't fluid motion. And the one of the ways you learn in the industry is they put you with somebody that's been doing it longer with you than you, and they get to see you up close and witness things, and it helps. Helps educate him. I learned from a lot of tag team partners over the years. But Bobby was had a credentials like Jack Briscoe, amateur background. He was a great athlete. I mean, he was a really good guy to be a partner with. But what I had heard, and all of it's hearsay because, first of all, Eddie's gone. Dusty's gone. Vince Sr.'s gone. So there's no way to actually given any kind of credential other than, okay, this story was one way, this story is the other way. I was told by Eddie at the beginning that Vince was interested in me being the champion because of my dad's background as military and an all-American boy kind of flag-waving son of a war hero. And it fit perfect into his territory because a lot of nationalities and they could create angles and they could create feuds between guys because of their backgrounds and where they're from. Well, he also made me the World Junior Heavyweight Champion and had me take the belt to Japan for New Japan Pro Wrestling and drop it to Fujinami to create an ambassadorship between New Japan Pro Wrestling and the WWWF, which Vince Sr. owned. So I was kind of like that middle piece that went over there and did the thing. And anyway, so I was told that when I came back, they were going to prepare me to go to New York. And I had already been up to New York a few times and worked the gardens. They had flown me and Dusty up there to work the gardens a few times. But one of the things was, is everybody's always come to me with this story and said, oh, man, just think if you'd have been the WWF world champion, what your career would have done. And I go, you know what? That didn't interest me at all. I wasn't interested in going to New York. I didn't want to go up there. And the reason I didn't wasn't because of the opportunity. It was because I had a fear of the cities. I mean, you know, when you travel the road in a car and you have to stop and ask directions, if you're not familiar with an area, and I would have had no clue how to get around New York City to get to Madison Square Gardens or Boston to get to the Boston Gardens or Philly. I mean, I had this fear of, you know, the unknown of going up there. So I was in a comfort zone of Florida, Georgia, you know, North Carolina and everything like that. But I mean, you know, it wasn't somebody waving a bone under my nose. And actually, then when I came back, Dusty and Eddie had me in the office and they told me, said, well, Vince has decided to go with Bobby and, you know, they're going to bring him up there and make him the champ and all that. And I'm going, great, a great opportunity for Bobby because Bobby wasn't from Florida. He was from Minneapolis. So he was used to being in the snow. And so When he went, I was all behind it. But later on, then I kept hearing the stories change. And then when it got to be a $50 bet, I mean, you know, I could see all of those stories being true, but I really can't verify which is the true story. was it that Vince wanted me, and then Eddie decided to keep me? The first story I heard, Eddie wanted to keep me from going because he didn't have anybody here to replace me in Florida. He didn't want to lose a main talent to Vince and then have a void here of filling in my spot. And so Eddie enticed me by staying, by saying, okay, well, I'm going to hang everything on you. He made me the Florida heavyweight champion. He made a Florida tag team. He made me the brass knucks champ. He made me the TV champ. I had more belts than I had equipment. And I mean, he just wrapped stuff around me to almost soothe me from losing that opportunity, which I didn't want to go to begin with. I mean, you know, and then later on, of course, Don Morocco and some of my friends, Kevin Sullivan, hey, why didn't you come to New York, man? They had you booked around as Andre the Giant's partner everywhere to get you over. And I said, well, I was told I wasn't supposed to go. So it's hard to say what's right and what's wrong, James. But, you know, when you know that you don't really know the truth, it's better to just admit, I really don't know which way was the real true story, but I've heard it a couple of different ways. So,
yeah, this, as you've said to me before, New York was cold, so that's a strike against. It's a very busy strike against. Let's say we take those two things out. Would you have been, because keep in mind, you would have been, what, about 26, 27, maybe somewhere around that, you know, maybe mid-late 20s. Would you have been, take those two equations out, you know, the cold, the weather, and the confusing cities and everything. Would you have been, at that point, mentally well-equipped to have an entire territory of that size on your shoulders, do you think?
Well, after going there a couple of times, like I said earlier, and appearing in the gardens, it would have taken some changes and dramatic changes. Because, first of all, the ring, which is so vitally important to your performance. All rings at that time were 18 by 18, and they were steel cable with a garden hose around them for the ropes. In the WWF, it was 20 by 20 ring. It had real ropes that don't recoil you as fast as the cable ropes. And just the comfort zone of being in the ring and utilizing the ropes and things that I had done more as a younger guy, hitting the ropes, the speed, and utilizing different maneuvers and stuff with the ring, that I was going to have a learning curve. And then the other thing was, is the wrestling style. The wrestling style of every place that I had worked had all been similar because it was NWA mostly, except for in Japan and Europe and places you'd have to go and learn their style and try to change yours, but not change your actual personality and adapt. Well, in New York, every time I wrestled there, and it was twice, once was Larry Sharp and the other was Johnny Rods, both of them were to whole match were telling me, slow down, slow down. You don't need to do that. Slow down, slow down. Stop. This ain't real here. I mean, you know, because I'd light you up. And I was into intense working, wrestling, and making believability out of stuff. And even if I mean, you know, to me, in my work, there was two moves that were always real. And that was if I slapped you in the face or I chopped you. So if I slapped you, I slapped you seriously. And you better have your mouth locked so I don't snap your jaw. But it's a move that doesn't hurt. And in front of an audience, it's stinging, yeah, and you feel it. But it makes a lot of noise and makes people go, whoa. And the same with the chop. Guys would chop, and if they really chopped you, you could hear it throughout the whole arena. But if they missed you, you still had to react to it, even though you knew that it was horrible. So when I went there, working with guys that didn't want to do anything, they were slow, they were lazy, they didn't move around much, I was going like, man, my style just might not fit in here, so I might have to really change. And I didn't learn that later on until I went to Tennessee and I realized I had to change somewhere, and there's where I changed. So anyway.